Welcome to C++ Now 2015.
Thank you. So, thank you, Marshall, for the excellent introduction. My name is Andrew Sutton. I'm a faculty member at the University of Akron in Ohio. This is what our university looks like. I found these pictures this morning. That one happens to be my building, so I put it in. And this one, of course, highlights our lovely sporting complex, which is essential for every major university in America. What?
Go Zips.
Go Zips, that's right. Fear the Rue. If you guys don't know anything about Akron, there are a couple of things you guys should know in case you ever decide to tour there. Akron is the home of Goodyear, surprisingly not founded by the guy who invented vulcanized rubber, about 50 years after his death. Also the home of LeBron James, if you guys are NBA fans. They play in the finals tonight, so I will be camped in front of a TV watching that, I'm sure. Okay, so at the university, like most of my research at the university is primarily involved in work related to software engineering and programming languages. Lately, I've been working on compilers, for better or worse. I know that some people in the audience who work on compilers can verify that statement. And lately, it's still there. And lately, actually, some fairly low-level networking stuff, encoding and decoding of protocols and language support for that. So really what I do is pretty much anything related to programming. I like programming. I love programming. What I really like about programming is being able to find a nice balance between abstraction and performance. Hopefully we can, hopefully we can find ways to write programs that are highly abstract, you know, in terms of the problem domain, and yet not sacrifice any performance. Unfortunately, that doesn't really always happen. We always have some kinds of trade-offs. But this is one of the things that actually led me into generic programming, because templates give us the ability to actually write fairly high-level code that compiles down to very, very fast executable programs until you get into generic programming. And then you learn things about enable if and sphene. And lovely things. And all of a sudden, the beautiful abstractions that you thought you were going to write using templates start looking quite, well, you know, nasty. So a lot of my recent work over the last 5 years, has it been 5 years? 5 years, is to provide language support for, or improve language support for generic programming in C++. And all of that kind of revolves around this idea of concepts. That is, we want to be able to allow programmers to write their templates in terms of some nicely named, nicely formed abstractions, or instead of these vague placeholders like T and N. One of the nice things we can get doing this is we improved compiler diagnostics, and just by a show of hands, how many people have been bit by compiler diagnostics for templates? I see people whose hands are down. I'm confused. One of the constraints that we have on this implementation or this design is that we can't impact the runtime of templates at all, because as soon as you start affecting the runtime of template code, you've broken C++, and nobody will ever use it for the things that we use it for these days. So there are a couple of people responsible for this design or this work. This guy on the right should be obvious. Gabby was also involved, helped fund me while I was a postdoc at Texas A&M. Gabby's up there. He'll correct me on my slides, I'm sure. And of course, Bjarne, who I also worked for as a postdoc at Texas A&M, has helped contribute in a lot of major ways to this design. So the result of that work is a language design called Concepts Lite. This is an extension of C++. It provides language support for generic programming. Really, it supports the definition of concepts as elements of a program, so we can actually write them in our program instead of leaving them in tables and documentation. We can use those concepts to constrain generic algorithms or templates. We support the notion of refinement of concepts, so we can overload or partially specialize based on that refinement. And we also included notation to help simplify the writing of constraints, which turns out to be fairly helpful and sort of changes the way that we actually look at generic programs altogether. This work is not done in isolation. For those of you that aren't aware of this has been ongoing work with the ISO or WG21. So there's a Concepts Lite, there's an ISO technical specification for concepts that standardizes the Concepts Lite spec or design. We are currently receiving and addressing national body comments, after which this will become a published technical specification, which is a formal extension of the C++ programming language. And after that, we're going to look at moving it into C++ 17, fingers crossed, we hope. There is an implementation of this, so it's not vaporware. It's implemented as a branch of GCC, so if you guys want to go grab the branch, it's called C++-concepts, all lowercase. It's still under active development. In fact, I committed to it this morning. And we actually expect it to be merged into GCC 6, well, 6, period. Sometime in this release cycle, I hope. I got email last week asking if it was ready, and I said, pretty much. Submit bugs to Jason. These are the guys that helped me out with the implementation. Jason is a C++ maintainer for Red Hat. Braden Oberzet is a student at Akron. He helped with the implementation of Concepts this year for part of a master's thesis. Actually, he's not a student anymore. He graduated last week. Yay. He also implemented variable templates, the initial implementation of that. So if you guys are using GCC and have written a variable template, thank Braden. And the occasional patch from Ville Vutilainen, who's Finnish national body chair and occasionally dabbles in compiler stuff, mostly writing test cases. Still very helpful. Okay. Oop. Nice blank slide. So this is the overview. There's my overview of the talk. Every talk has to have an overview, right? So this is my overview slide. I'm going to give you guys a very, very gradual introduction to concepts. Actually, what I should do is just open the technical specification and read from it. That would burn an hour and a half pretty quickly. So I'm going to give you guys a very gradual definition of concepts, sort of how they work in the language and motivate the problems that they solve. Then I'm going to talk about defining concepts and using them, and then a very, very rapid outro, so hopefully there's some time for Q&A at the end. I don't know how long this talk lasts. It should be under an hour and a half. Well, it will be, because I have somebody holding up cards saying how long I have. I'm not diving into talk about generic programming using templates in the usual way. Like every single talk that I've ever given on concepts and generic programming, and most of the talks that I see on concepts or templates and generic programming, tends to start with examples of templates. I'm not doing that. In fact, I was trying to see how far I could go in my talk before I even showed a template, which is surprisingly quite far. And the reason for that is that I actually want to establish kind of the background, the basis for why we have these things, why we want them, what problems they solve, or at least what problems we're trying to solve with them. So that's why we have this very, very gradual introduction. So we are going to start at the very beginning. A programming language provides us a way of textually representing computation. Structure and meaning of the structure and content of that text gives rise to its meaning in one way or another, right? There's two ways we can look at that. If you're a compiler, you're going to take that text, you're going to translate it into executable code through one or more phases of translation, I'm sure. If you're a programmer, then the structure of that program and the text of it, the content of the text, tells us what it is that program actually does. Make sense? All right, let's see how well you've internalized this. Here's a function. What does it do? Shout it out if you know. It took my undergrads a couple minutes.
Computes an average.
How do you know it? Magic? I hope that's not the answer. We all write code by spewing forth magic into our editors.
You're accumulating the range of numbers, and you're dividing by the distance.
Yeah. Tony?
It has a bug because you're incrementing b and then subtracting at the end. So g minus b is 1 or 0.
Good thing this slide never shows up again in my talk. Jesus Christ. Assume we did this correctly.
That's what you're doing in mind. And compiler meaning and argument.
That's right. And magic.
Exit initialized here?
Yes. Value initialized. So the reason, it's hard to go back and actually think about why you know what programs do. Right. But since I've been sort of locked into teaching for quite a while, you actually get to go back and think about how you teach people to think about these things. And the way that we do this is that we teach people what the names mean. Everybody knows what double is. We all know what plus means, or not equals. Apparently some of us know what minus means. Division. And so we build up this knowledge about these names in the language. We know what types are, we know what values they represent, we know what operators there are on them, and we know what those operators do. And so we can actually walk through the lines of this program and establish some kind of meaning about it, for better or worse. right? So this is basically what I just said. Every language has built-in names. Every language associates meanings with those names. So for example, we know what int is, we know what bool is, we know what double does, we know what all of these operators do. And you know, if we're lucky, well, actually, quickly walk through x plus y. It adds, signs, equals, anybody? We can have long discussions about what equals actually means. We can have long discussions about each of these. Actually, each of these could probably be a lecture in itself. Equals, we know it's true if x is equal to y and less than, if x is less than y for some definition of less. So we have expected behaviors there. We also associate expected behaviors with certain syntactic forms. Like whenever you declare a variable, whenever a variable goes out of scope, we know that we invoke certain behaviors. A constructor runs when you declare something, when you dynamically allocate an object. Whenever that object goes out of scope, you call the destructor. Or whenever you delete something, you call the destructor. Sometimes those destructors and constructors do nothing. But, you know, morally, we do that thing. So if I write type x, what do we expect in C++? Where type is some built-in type, one of our usual base types. Anybody? Ah, no. Default initialized. Declares x, default initialized. What about type y equals x? This is the obvious one. Yeah, declares x, declares y as a copy of x, invokes a copy constructor perhaps. So for every type that we have in the language, the behavior is a little bit different, right? The semantics of those operations on different types turn out to be a little bit different. The A plus B means one thing for integers, like an add instruction. A plus B for floats means a floating point add instruction. So the behavior is a little bit different. But in general, we see things like A plus B, and we know that there's some kind of similar behavior here. And generalizing the notion of that behavior turns out to be a little bit difficult, but we know that plus is addition, except for strings, and then it's concatenation, right? And so it'd be really surprising if, for example, we started adding types to language for which something like equals or equality did something other than returning true when two things were equal, except for NaN, because NaN is weird. Right. And if you guys want to see a really nice talk on how things are broken, there's this guy by Gary Bernhardt. Has anybody seen this talk? He has a blog called Destroy All Software. He talks about dynamic programming language, like what happens when you add two arrays in JavaScript. You get an empty string. It's fantastic. Beautiful talk. If you haven't seen it, go look it up. So this is what happens when you get things wrong. But you know, C++, we actually expect things to be consistent. And so when somebody writes an algorithm like this, we know that it's wrong, right, Tony? But we still know what it does. Modulo details, right? Maybe we actually get some signed integer overflow, but that's details. We can still look at it. We can say, this is computing the average of a sequence of numbers, sort of. Oh. OK, so one of the big features of C++, one of the design goals of C++, and I think this is kind of overlooked or not really talked about quite as much as it should be, is that C++ strives very hard to be consistent with user-defined types and built-in types, so that we can declare and use built-in or user-defined types just the same way that we do with built-in types. So for example, if I want to have a rational numbers, which is just a pair of ints, I could write rational r equals something. And that works just like writing int n equals something else, because we're consistent, right? Contrast that to Java. Like a rational is a pair of ints, and yet somehow because this is a class down here, now it has to be allocated dynamically, and now there's an indirection. And so we lose a lot of power because of that indirection there. But C++, because it works hard to actually make our built-in user-defined types look like our built-in types, this stuff works out and it guarantees us a nice level of performance. Right. And along with that, as part of this, we get the ability to do things like overload operators. Because if we're going to make data structures or user-defined types look and work like built-in types, then surely they share some of the same syntax. Complex numbers can be added. Rational numbers can be added. Strings can be added. Concatenated. You know, we overload equality operator all the time because we want to know when two objects have the same value. We overload operator less all the time. Well, not as often as equals. We overload less frequently because sometimes our user-defined types have a natural ordering to them. Right? And when we go about doing this, what we really want to try to do is we want to try to not break programmer expectation with what we already know about the built-in types. I mean, if you're going to overload equals for a built-in type and you modify your arguments, that's probably not a very good implementation. Like it certainly breaks expectations, right? And we do the same thing with constructors too. We allow constructors and destructors to be invoked on declaration allocation because we want to do things like acquire resources or establish an initial variable or initial value or establish invariants. Right? That's what constructors do. Destructors, they get invoked at the same time they would for built-in types to release those resources. So, like, allocate memory, deallocate memory, acquire a lock, release a lock. Maybe, unless you're doing lock-free programming. Right. So here's a really simple point class. Tony, type check, please. Just a pair of doubles, has a default constructor, initializes to the origin. It has an addition operator, or plus equals operator, that takes another point and it adds component-wise. We have a division operator that divides by some scalar value d. And of course, there would be more declarations, because if these were the only members in your class, you would not get a very good grade on my homework. Because they're scalars, and because we can do things like this. Anybody know what this does? What? Crashes, yeah. If it were right.
Isn't X meant to be a point?
God. Going to fire my editor. There we go. And the return value. Fix the return value. Notes to self. Okay. Do we know what it does? I should have just read the spec. What does it do? Gives you the centroid of a point of a cloud of points. There's a reasonable reason for having an operator, division operator on it. So. Three algorithms, all with the same bug. this one with an extra one. They all do the same thing in various domains, right? Average, or the arithmetic mean of floating point numbers, the arithmetic mean of integers, centroid of a cloud of points. That's one of the things that we get from actually allowing different syntaxes with the same names. We can start overloading those names and taking advantage of them for writing programs. And really, it gives us the benefits to do, well, user-defined types give you the benefits to do a lot of interesting things. But of course, you know, with great power does come great responsibility. We should not do weird things. Copy constructors that modify arguments are a bit weird. I'm sure that sometime you can justify doing that sometimes. PowerPoint? Auto pointer, yes. Sometimes you can justify doing those things, but as I recall, auto pointer is now deprecated. Yes. And we don't do that anymore. Addition operators that actually subtract were kind of weird. A division operator that concatenates path names. I can buy into that one. I'm okay with that. There's a precedent, right? Okay, so. Most programs are a little bit more interesting than just pointers and addition. And so we also do the same thing with library types, right? Whenever we start to build up libraries, what we're really doing is defining sets of data structures, sets of types. And we build functions and operations around them. And they all have names that correlate to their specific behaviors. Now, when those data structures, if you have different data structures that for which you can do kind of the same thing or similar things, then it kind of behooves us to give those operations the same names, with the assumption, of course, that they do similar things and with similar complexities. Right? So inserting at the end of a resizable array or a vector, that's cool. Pushing back on a linked list, that's a nice thing. They're both constant time operations. Does anybody know, do we define pushback for singly linked list or forward list? No, we don't, because it's not fast. It's linear, right? And so when we give these operations different names, they should the similar behavior, they should be given the same names, assuming, of course, that they have similar semantics. This is a big thing. Like, don't start calling functions pushback unless they really do what you want with the performance that you want. So we can write little programs like this, hopefully correct. So here's just pushing back a vector into an element. And if I want to change that to a linked list, lots of changes. We just change the type. Even the variable name stays the same. I hope there's no bugs. And so We have exactly the same behaviors in both of these things with the difference of details, right? One is probably going to maybe reallocate some memory, depends on your default constructor for vectors, insert into a contiguous thing. This is going to do some pointer swapping, probably, or some pointer assignment, because those are the details. But the semantics are the same. You insert, the size grows, you have a new back. This is nice. Right? So why do we want to do this? Like, why is this a good thing? Why do we like having the same names for similar semantics? Well, reduced cognitive burden is one. That's my way of saying easier to remember stuff. Like, I don't have to think about the details of linked lists and vectors and decks when I start pushing back to them. I just know that they all kind of belong to this set of types that called a sequence or back insertion sequence for which I can perform this operation and they're efficient. I don't really have to think too much about the difference between an unordered set and a standard set because they're sets. I can insert, I can find, I can erase. Yeah.
Is purpose part of the semantic? Because X size is full end.
Nope. Not anymore.
Okay.
You repeat the
question? Sorry. The observation was that size for linked lists is big O n, and that was fixed in C++ 11, so that is now constant time. But yeah, I've run into that problem before. Don't lie about behaviors. So yeah, reduced cognitive burden is a big thing, right? It makes it easier for us to think about programs. In fact, actually, it was a number of years ago, maybe 2009, I was having a discussion with Andrew Lumsdain in Norway. He's from Indiana University. We were in Norway. And he made the statement that, you know, I think programmers really program in terms of concepts instead of data types. And I thought about it, and I thought about it, and I thought about it, and I said, you know, that's probably true. I don't really think in terms of the data structures that I'm working with. I think in terms of the abstractions they represent, like what a set is, what a map is, what a sequence is. The other reason we do this, the big reason we do this, is because it enables generic programming. Right? If you have a language that does not provide the ability to change the behavior of an operation based on, for different types, while sharing the same name, you cannot support generic programming, period. Maybe you can, but it might be very hard or slow, right? So what do I mean? Yeah, that's a macro. So when the names and semantics of certain types agree, we're allowed to define programs generally in terms of those abstractions. And yes, so the reason, by the way, I chose a macro here instead of a template is because I want to completely decouple these ideas from templates. We don't need to talk about generic programming and templates in the same breath, because the same principles that apply there also apply here. Except this is just worse, because there's no type checking whatsoever.
And it's name depend.
That's okay. There's nothing wrong with it.
Bottom line.
Oh, yes. I was type checking these in the morning. Not enough coffee, apparently. So append isn't, yeah. So the problem is that like this seems like it works really well, except that we don't really define append for every S and X, right? Like the validity of this fragment, this macro, really depends on what the type of S is and what the type of X is, and whether or not S has this pushback thing and whether or not X can actually be added to it. If you try calling append with 0 and 0, like clearly not going to work, but because it's a macro, it'll clearly pre-process for you and generate the sequence of tokens that you want. Right? So the question we actually have to ask is, for what set of types would this fragment of code actually be well formed? Right? And that's actually the deeper question. So we can start looking at types that might work with that. We know that there are sets of types that will work with that macro. Right? Hopefully it's a set with a name. But that set of types would have the same operations, the same semantics, or similar semantics. And it would work with append. So there's a couple ways we can go about forming this set. Well, first try, we could just enumerate every member of that set. And there are probably a lot of you guys in the audience that know how this is done. How many people know what an integral type is in C++? It is a list of all the types in C++ that are integral, built-in types in C++ that are integers. Right? So we actually do write some sets like this. We enumerate them. Floating point types. That's an easier set to do because it's float, double, and long double. Not too hard there. Okay. But, you know, with append, we don't really have a finite set. Because right, we have vector event, we have list event, we have vector vector event, we have vector 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 event, we have vector list events, we have vector list of vector event. So we can go forever, right? All of those are going to work with append. So what we really want to do is define each set by this by a predicate that determines whether or not that type is actually in the set or not. And this predicate is actually what ends up being called a concept. And this definition is one that I'm taking from Elements of Programming and from our work in N3351, which was the Palo Alto TR. So concept is just a predicate, determines when a type is in a particular set. It has a name, has some rules or some requirements, and it establishes what works and what doesn't for a particular set of algorithms. So concepts have two kinds of requirements. We have syntactic requirements, which are the sets of associated names and types and constant values or compile time values that we can look up at compile time, right? So we want to know for some type T, you know, is the expression A less than B well formed for all values of A and B? And by well formed, I mean it type checks. Not that it executes without undefined behavior or throwing an exception, just that we can actually compile this expression for some concrete type T. Or for all X of type S, we know that X.empty is going to be a valid type or valid expression, because it has some type, not that it actually executes correctly in all cases. We can test for these properties at compile time. How many people here have ever written a type trait that looks for the name of a function or the name of an associated type? Has anybody written a type trait that looks for a value? Has anybody written a type trait that looks for the name of a template? No, because you can't find the names of templates at compile time. You can only find types of values and types and values, and that's about it. True. You can find a specialization, you cannot find the name of a template. Okay. So we also have semantic requirements, right? We can't just stop at syntax because, look, I can write equals and I can write less and I can define pushback for any type and I can give them whatever meaning I want. That is not a very productive thing to do. So we actually write semantic requirements for concepts axiomatically. So for example, if we require operator less as a syntactic requirement, we should have a semantic requirement saying that it's a strict weak order on the elements of T, or the values of T. If we have a syntactic requirement for empty, x.empty, then we should have some semantic expression that defines what it does, which is to say that it's always equal to size equals zero. But I think there's a note that it might be faster. Right? Semantic properties cannot be detected at runtime, at compile time. I'm waiting for Gabby to look up and correct me. But this is open research. There might be some that actually can, which is a very, very interesting branch of research. So, just a notational thing. So a type that satisfies the syntactic and semantic requirements of a concept is said to be a model of that concept, or that the type models that concept. Because we can't check semantic properties at compile time, we can only expect that the semantics are satisfied if the syntactic requirements are satisfied. At this point, that becomes upon a burden for the programmer of that data type to actually test conformance, either through, you know, rigorous testing, code review. If you guys have sweet tools, automated reasoning tools, they're out there. Hopefully they start working soon and becoming free. Okay, so quick summary of all of that. Different types, both built-in and user-defined types, have similar syntaxes with similar behaviors. That is really what enables generic programming. In fact, actually, generic programming is all about concepts. Concepts are predicates on types that actually characterize them or categorize those types into sets that we can use to constrain or to describe these fragments of code. And so that really, when we talk about generic programming, we're really talking about concepts. Because it is simply not possible for you guys to write a template or a macro without having some preconceived notion about what your template arguments are. And those turn out to be concepts, yes. So the question is, when you instantiate a template, isn't it self-checking? And is that about right?
Yeah.
Yes, kind of. The problem is that you get into this instantiation stack, and now whenever you get type errors, what you end up getting are really nasty compile time errors. Like, you haven't said what's expected of your template arguments at all. You're just sort of inferring that the programmer is going to look at your definition and figure out what it is that you mean. Right. Okay. So let's look at this in a little bit more detail. Actually, no, let's look at grown-up code. There we go. For the sake of argument, I'm going to assume that element type is defined elsewhere, and it's just going to give me some type that's unnamed that is related to S in some way, namely that whatever that type is, you can put it back, put it into S, perhaps. Right. So the original question that we asked was what set of types work with this algorithm? And I'm going to rephrase that a little bit. I'm going to say what's required of our template arguments? What are we going to substitute for S? What can we substitute for S that when we instantiate the template is going to generate a correct algorithm? Not really just one that happens to generate, you know, well-formed code, but actually correct. Like satisfying preconditions mean you're going to also effectively satisfy your postconditions. That's a much stronger question to ask. And to rephrase this one more time, I'm going to ask what concept constrains the algorithm so that its instantiation for some type that models that concept is going to be correct, right? So if we constrain this template with some concept C, and I have a type T that models that concept, it satisfies its requirements, then substitution, instantiation of this template with that type will be a correct algorithm. Like, that's the goal here, right? So how do we find that out? How do we discover this? How do we look? Well, I mean, the first thing we have to do is we have to look at the syntax of the algorithm itself. We have to find names in this algorithm that are actually dependent on S, or that depend on S, right? So element type depends on S, it's template argument. Whatever the result of this alias template is, it has something to do with S, unless it's type def to int or something like that. But it still has something to do with S here, so that's all that matters. Pushback also does this, right? You can't resolve pushback without looking it up through S, and S has some dependent type, and so therefore, whatever the meaning of this is, we have to express some requirement for that in our code. Right? So names, element type, and pushback are dependent on S. Now we have to look at meaning. What does element type mean? This is actually kind of a weird one. I'm not really sure if this is right. Basically, it's just an alias for an unspecified type. So if it resolves, that's pretty good. But we're almost sure that this has to be an object type. Now, whether or not that has to be a constraint or a requirement for the concept that constrains this algorithm, I'm not quite sure. That might actually be somewhere else. But it's probably going to be an object type. Pushback is more interesting, right? Because what is pushback supposed to do? Well, the macro is called append, so there's that. So it copies x into the end of the sequence. The size grows by one, right? What else? It's probably constant time. We should require that it's amortized constant time with respect to size. Anything else? Back is now equal to x after insertion.
It's supposed to have at least amortized constant time.
We said that. I said that. It's actually on the next slide, too. There's one more thing. Am I allowed to write a pushback that deletes all the previous elements? No, we probably want to keep those around. That's not a very effective append, is it? Right. So what pushback means is that we're going to put something into x. We're going to append an element to x such that the size has grown by 1. The back is equal to x. The values of the previous element are retained. This is not to say they haven't been moved, just that the values are the same. Insertion is amortized constant time. So this is what we actually want these things to do. Right. So what we're going to say is that S is a sequence. With a footnote, technically this is a back insertion sequence from the SGI documentation, but I'm abbreviating it as sequence because back insertion sequence does not fit elegantly into my slides. That's a deep reason for doing things. So a sequence actually imposes its own set of requirements. It has to be a linear ordering of elements in its type, or a linear arrangement. If you don't have that linear arrangement, things kind of fall apart, because otherwise you'd have push back into a set, and sets kind of reorder arbitrarily. Provides access to the last element, provides removal at the end of the sequence, insertion, removal at the end of the sequence, and all of those are amortized constant time. Now I'll get back to you. Okay. So now, here's our algorithm. We can say that S is required to be a sequence type. Or, just by the way, whenever I say sequence for the rest of this talk, assume back insertion sequence. Okay, so these concepts always come from algorithms, right? Like we don't just sort of magically make them up and go, I have an idea for an abstraction. It'll have operator X and function Y. And here are the semantics. Now we always start with algorithms, and we always try to figure out what syntax is required by that algorithm and what are the semantics required by that, by those names that are in our algorithm that are needed to guarantee the post conditions. Right? If you don't guarantee the post conditions in your semantic requirements, then you're basically just going to end up with logically incorrect programs all over the place, and it's bad. So we don't generate concepts by looking at data structures. We don't look for commonalities. We don't factor these things out like, oh, these data structures all have the same name, so therefore there's a concept called C that has this projection on these types. That's not really where they come from. They don't come from looking at a single operation trying to find the most general semantics for it, like, hey, look, there's operator less. How can we define the semantics of that? Chandler tells me it's a total order. Just kidding, Chandler. Or maybe it's a partial order, or maybe it's not. So we don't just sort of look at single operators in isolation and try to pin down semantics for them. We look at the use of these names or these operators in algorithms. We try to derive the semantics that make the algorithms actually work. And I added this last one last night, because I was thinking about it, and I really couldn't make a good argument about the semantics that I wanted for a sequence without saying that, yes, there are other algorithms related to a sequence that also have these requirements. So we don't have a one-to-one mapping between algorithm and concept, right? The semantics that we have for the concepts, the syntax and semantics we define for a concept, really establishes or is established by a family of algorithms that all operate in kind of the same way. So appending a sequence of elements to the end of a vector is very closely related to appending a single element. Appending a sequence of n default initialized elements is very closely related to the same thing too. Right? And there's kind of a flip side of this. So once you know the concept, once you've internalized it, you know the names, the syntax, and the semantics, then all those algorithms, that family of algorithms you use to motivate it, and even algorithms you haven't thought to write yet, follow from the semantics that you've defined for those operations. Right? So effectively what we do is we establish sort of a theory with names attached to it, and we can start deriving algorithms that are known to be correct based on that theory. And this, by the way, how many people have actually read Elements of Programming? That's not enough hands. There should be more hands for this. This is actually how Elements of Programming is laid out. Like chapter 2, here's a transform. And here are all of the algorithms that we can derive from the theory of transforms on operations. So once we've established the ideas, we can start building algorithms around those. The syntax that we use for those names, those operator names, let us do some really interesting things. Namely, generic programming. And the way that we actually write those in C++, well, no, sorry. The way that we write those in the Concepts TS is through Concepts Lite, which is now the rest of my talk. So, Concepts Lite was designed to provide the ability to define concepts and constrain templates and overload and partially specialize based on those constraints while making the smallest possible changes to C++. So there are some things in the syntax that you're going to look at and you're going to go, huh, that's weird. Why didn't you do this? And the answer is minimal design. And then last June happened in Rapperswil, and suddenly Concepts Lite became a little bit bigger. We picked up some new features, yay, that added quite a bit to the specification. Okay, so what we've said of sequence is roughly this. A type T is a sequence if and only if it has the following associated types and names with the corresponding semantics. So, you know, element type has to be the associated element type. T.size returns the number of elements in T. Empty tells you when it's empty or when T.size is equal to zero. What else we have? Back is the last element, and pushback appends. There are others. This is not a complete definition. Begin and end would probably be nice to have. Front, maybe. So this is what we want to say. This is what we're asking. These are the syntactic requirements for the concept of syntax. So how do we write that in Concepts? Well, like this. It's a lot to digest. Don't worry, I'll go through it bit by bit. This is the concept definition for a sequence. Right? Now, concepts, when we declare a concept or define a concept, We always introduce them with a type specifier concept because that's what makes it a concept. Remember when you said that a concept is a predicate? Yeah, that's a predicate. Concept is also, by the way, it implies context, bro. Right? So this is really a compile time predicate on whatever template argument T is. Concepts also makes it a little bit magic in some other ways, but since I'm not actually talking about the language specification, suffice to say it adds limitations to what you can actually do with these things. Like, you cannot define a recursive concept. Do not try. This is not a Turing complete system. All right, so it's just a function. It's context per function plus a little bit extra, or minus a little bit extra. And all it does is it returns a single expression. Really what it returns is a conjunction of, actually let's see here, a conjunction of expressions. And both of these happen to be these little requires expressions. So this is a new expression in C++. It lets us specify syntactic requirements. And all of you guys who have ever written a type trait will be happy to see that I can specify the requirement for an associated type like that. This is a type requirement. It starts with type name and gives the name of the type you want after. So instead of some template machinery to do this, we just state that I require, whenever I substitute some argument for T, that lookup gives me a type. That's all that says. Now the other one, I split these up because I wanted a type requirement here, and I'm going to use it in the next one. So the second requirement actually adds something a little bit different. We can actually add parameters to this requires expression. These parameters actually don't do anything. They don't have memory, they have no linkage. They're really just here to establish names that we can use for resolution. How many people love decalval? Serious? Love decalval? Oh my god. What? Decaltype is fantastic. Decalval makes code hard to write. Like, this was supposed to replace decalval, because I got tired of writing it, so I added some parameters that didn't do anything. Used purely to write type names for resolution. Right. So this is technically called the compound requirement because there are multiple requirements inside it. The first part occurs in braces. This is just an expression. So this is an expression that's required to be valid, or a valid expression. Whenever we substitute some concrete type into it, we require a lookup to succeed and define some type for this thing. And if you can, then okay, that's satisfied. If you can't, then your concept fails and it's not satisfied. And after the braces, we have an arrow int, which says that the result type of that expression has to be convertible to int, implicitly convertible to int. And if t.size turns out to be convertible to int, that's good. If it's not, your concept fails and it's not satisfied. And then all the rest of them are basically the same. Right, so check to see that empty compiles, check to see that its result is convertible to bool, back compiles, convertible to element type, push back compiles. No convertibility requirement because we actually don't care what happens at the end of pushback. It's not specified. That's not the same as saying that it's void. It's just unspecified. Okay, so here's the whole thing again. This is the entire concept definition. Now, how do we use it? Right? Oh, actually, sorry, one slide too early. Yes?
Is the concept always followed by bool?
Yes. The question was, concept is always followed by bool, and the answer is yes. No int, no char, no double. That'd be weird. No auto, that's out too. Yeah.
So all of those say that the return type is convertible to that type. Is there a way to say that the return type is exactly the same?
There is. You use a constant expression with a constraint, like is same of those decal type of those things. There are easier ways to say that, but I haven't included them in my presentation.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, I'm sorry. Is there a way to say that the result type has to be exactly that type? And the answer is not really. There's no easy syntax for it. There was at one point, but we took it out because we never actually used it. Okay. So what Concepts Lite does not allow you to do is actually specify the semantics. We can't say what it is these operators actually mean, right? But just because you can't write the semantics in the code, don't think that means that you can't actually avoid writing semantics. You should write semantics for concepts. And by the way, that's where this actually gets difficult. If you write a concept that has no semantics associated with it, you have not defined a very good concept because things actually do stuff. Those operators, those names have behaviors. You can't omit that. Make sure it's part of your reference documentation for your manuals or for your web pages or your libraries, right? Okay. So now how do we use these things? Well, here's an unconstrained template. Simple algorithm. Hope I got this one right. Please, please be right. So this is basically a simple algorithm that takes a sequence and pushes back some sequence of some arbitrary number of random numbers, random integers, assume that random int exists and it does the right thing. And then it used to not return. I was returning S at one point. I'm a bad programmer. Well, at least I'm bad at writing slides. So it does these things, right? And then, eventually we come along, we write the wrong stuff. You know, maybe I'm going to try to call this with an int. I mean, clearly nobody is going to do this because everyone knows that randomize would take a sequence and not an int. But you still get these errors, especially in deeply nested generic code, where you sometimes forget to dereference things, or sometimes you're missing a const qualifier, or somehow a reference has evaporated or something has decayed, and you have no idea what happened to that original type because of all the template metaprogram machinery that is modifying it on the fly. This does happen. You get nasty template errors out of it. This will not happen in main, I hope. Maybe for CS1. Right. So when we actually apply a concept to a template, what we're going to do is ask if the arguments, template arguments for that template satisfy the concept. Which basically means we take the concept, we substitute the arguments through. If it turns out that everything checks, everything is satisfied, then we allow the instantiation to continue. If anything fails, you get a type error, you get a substitution failure, anything. Concept is not satisfied, compilation, instantiation does not succeed, and you get some error like, I don't know, you get some error like a no call, right? Constraints are checked at the point of use. That's important. They actually check before we enter the instantiation phase of the definition. That's what prevents us from getting these nasty template errors, right? As soon as you instantiate a template, you walk into the definition, you have a new context. Actually, how many people write in Python or JavaScript or some other dynamic language, right? So you guys know what happens when you get a type error like in your call stack. What happens? You cry, but it also prints the entire call stack when you get the exception, right? That's exactly what happens with type errors in templates, except instead of a runtime stack, it's the instantiation stack, right? So we always check before entering. So this is how we constrain a template, or this is how we're going to constrain this template. Instead of writing type name, we're just going to write the name of the sequence as part of the declaration of the template parameter. This means that T must be a sequence type. I should have just had this one slide and then talked about it for an hour. That's all we're doing with concepts. That's how we constrain this template. Again, ignore the return. So now if we misuse that template, still doing the same thing, still missing our const qualifier or whatever. It's still ill-formed. Like, concepts aren't going to fix your bad use of my algorithm, right? But the syntax, the error that you actually get is something along the lines of now, okay, you can't call randomize because guess what? The constraints aren't satisfied. And by the way, that's actually the real compiler error. Yeah.
Does it say which part of the constraint is not satisfied? Yes. Inside which
I used to dump, sorry, the question was, let me see if I can actually rephrase that in a slightly different way. Does the diagnostic tell you what all of the causes of failure for the satisfaction was? I used to. I used to enumerate every single requirement that failed so you would know exactly what went wrong. And then I realized that generates so many errors that it was completely useless. So I took it out, and now you just get a very succinct one, and I'm still working back some heuristics to actually give you interesting, useful information, more useful information.
Well, I was just going to comment more on that.
Maybe later?
No, you pretty much covered it.
Oh, good. Fantastic. And I will continue. All right. Now, for simple algorithms, this is actually pretty easy. You have one template parameter, you write one constraint, yeah.
Will this also be checked for the algorithm itself, not only for the instantiation? Will it also check that randomize only uses S as a sequence and not as a monotone?
Yes. So are we checking the use of S, right? I'm trying. I'm sorry, what? Ah, no. So the question is, do we guarantee that within the body of the algorithm that you only use the operations that have been required by your concepts? And the answer is no. That's what's called separate checking. Concepts Lite does not do that. We opted to focus on call side checking for this iteration. And come back later and address separate checking in a separate pass. Right. Okay, so For simple concepts with a single parameter, like this is pretty easy. You can just use the template name. The concept name is the part of this part of the template declaration. That's fine. But what usually happens, and this is true of most algorithms that I tend to write, is that we have multiple template parameters that in some way or another depend on each other. Right? So here I have a sequence S, and I'm still going to like walk through it. I know I forgot the constraints for begin and end, but they exist. And you know, for every X that satisfies pred, we're going to increment some count. It's count. It's the count algorithm, right? Now the problem is that I have not really given a constraint for what P is. There's nothing in the declaration of this template that announces how I intend to use predicate within the body of this function. And that's actually not a good thing, right? Because this is an under-constrained template. It's actually a partially constrained template. And that pretty much gets us back to just generally unconstrained templates in the general case. If we pass an argument in that doesn't satisfy the requirements of pred, like the address of a member function, because we think that some transformation is going to happen, but it doesn't there, right? Then the errors are still going to be exactly the same kind of things we get before. It's unconstrained, and so that type will pass all the way through, and then you'll get back to trying to write this as syntax for a pointer to a member function, and it ain't going to work. You're going to get a type error. You're going to get an instantiation stack, right? So what we actually have to do is specify, when we have multiple parameters that depend on each other in some way, we have to specify additional constraints that sort of bridge those parameters. One way we can do this is with the requires clause. And by the way, for those interested in history, the original design of Concept Lite had only a requires clause, but this tends to be a bit verbose. So we shortened it a little bit. So this requires clause is followed by an expression. It's a constant expression. All the terms are Boolean, and you can pretty much use and or, and that's about it. Actually, that's not true. It's just a constant expression. Ignore what I just said. Right. So here, predicate is going to be a concept. P is the template parameter. P sequence or element type is the element type of S, or whatever we've established by the concept up here, sequence. And now we've fully constrained this, right? Because this says, well, let me show you what predicate looks like first. This is what predicate looks like. It's just another concept. It takes some type P, and aha, more fun, a parameter pack of args. And so this concept is satisfied when we can actually call pred with those args, expanded, and the result type is convertible to bool. This is how we define predicate. And so now, if we try to pass something in like a pointer to a member function, we try to substitute the pointer to a member function through this predicate, and we get to that line where it tries to substitute through, and it fails, and this concept is not satisfied, so you would not be able to use this function. Yes?
So in this case, that predicate actually would change the requirements slightly because as without the unconstrained version, would it require contextual conversion to bool rather than implicit conversion?
So the question is, does this change? I think you're asking if it changes the behavior of the algorithm because there's some implied conversion here, right?
Isn't there a contextual conversion?
This is a contextual conversion bool, right?
You could push a return type. So if you don't have the constraints, then some things would work, which would no longer work when you have the constraints. Yes.
I don't think so. Yes.
I think what he's saying is that because this is in an if statement, it triggers all the contextual conversions.
Sure.
Things that are like explicit conversions to bool will work.
Yes. Okay, you're right.
Your predicate checking.
You're right. So the question is there a semantic difference between this algorithm where it's unconstrained and this algorithm where it is constrained? And the answer, you're right. Because this constraint requires implicit conversion, and not doesn't allow for an explicit conversion, it would prematurely reject certain viable arguments for, oops, that's not right. Wrong button. It will reject certain viable arguments for this algorithm. And I think this is something that Eric and I have discussed through email at some point or another, that this requirement might need to be a little bit stronger to allow for these contextual conversions, to make sure that we don't falsely reject viable candidates there. Good question. Stop catching errors. Yes. It mostly works.
This might be a digression, but the predicate here is a template, so it's sort of like a template context for a function returning bool, right?
Yeah. It is a...
It's always returning bool, and you said about that. You didn't say why there are always this pair of empty parentheses. Is there ever anything in the parentheses?
There is nothing ever, so the question is there ever anything in the parentheses? And the answer is no, you are not allowed to put arguments, you're not allowed to write arguments or give arguments to a concept, no. And the follow-up question is obviously going to be, why don't you use variable templates? And the answer is that you can use variable templates as concepts too, but those are newer and I like writing function concepts anyways. So I'm showing you this and not the other. Remember, minimal changes. Variable templates didn't exist when we started designing it. Yeah.
So why do you leave the concept here?
Because it's not actually a function. So the question is, why do we need the concept keyword? Concepts do very interesting things. Like, for starters, they're never actually instantiated. They also go through a bunch of analyses in the back end. Like, this is all the stuff that happens in the specification that I could have read to you line by line and page by page. But there are a lot of transformations that happen to the body of this thing that you would never ever want to happen to a regular function construct per function. For example, because this is never instantiated, you never get into a separate instantiation, a non-immediate instantiation context, so all of your type errors are sort of lifted into sort of a Sphene context for checking. So it's always, almost always Sphene friendly. Like, there's a lot of stuff that we do in the back end that concept enables, yeah. Does requires work outside of concepts? Ask me that question when I get to the end of the slot talk, because I have a very good answer to it. Yeah.
If the predicate had like a static assert in it,
If the concept had a static assert, and the answer to that is no, you can only have a return statement. It's like the old constexpr per rule. Good answer? It's an answer. Okay. Now the unfortunate downside of actually having fully specified constraints in your interface is that sometimes you have lots of template parameters, and inner product is my favorite one of these because the requirements on this just tend to be nasty. Literally, like 5 or 6 lines of requirements here. We don't really want to write that. So we actually ended up adding syntax into the language that would allow us to simplify that constraint a little bit. And this is called a template introduction. So we can kind of factor out a bunch of constraints and just sort of assign it to a concept. This is just a predicate like anything else, concept, bool, whatever, generalize this thing, except that it takes a bunch of different template parameters and evaluates the entire set of constraints against those things. So this syntax you have a concept name, followed by a sequence of identifiers. These are the template parameters that are identified, that are created by that are specified by that concept. They're declared as template parameters for this declaration. And so you can kind of omit all of the declaration complexity for inner product, but just by using this template introduction syntax. Now, when we originally designed this, it wasn't actually for one-off uses. That wasn't the intent. We just kind of happened to notice that when we were writing the algorithms for like the mergeable algorithms, that they all had the same stuff. They all required, they had exactly the same template parameters, they had same constraints, and so when you see this, you're like, okay, well, those things belong to a family, maybe we should have a single kind of declaration or some annotation that kind of connected them in a way that made it very obvious that they were related in a family. Are you going to say that set intersect is not the right algorithm? Yeah. It's not, but if I wrote set intersection, it would slide off the end of the slide. Yeah. There is no possible. There's no possibility for ambiguity because that thing that happens in front has to be a concept name, and you can't brace initialize a concept.
And there's no way that can be a dependent name, is there?
There is no way that could be a dependent name. That cannot be a dependent name. Because you always have to do a lookup, and you always have to find the concept. If you don't find a concept, if you find something, then it's not going to work. You get an error. Can concepts be members? No. Concept definitions cannot be members because there is a dependent name lookup problem there. All right, some of your algorithms turn out to be very, very simple. If they take 1 or 2 parameters, for example, and the constraints are obvious, we allow you to actually just use the concept as a type specifier. And so if you want to write reverse for a sequence, you can simply write reverse for a sequence of S, and this will actually give you the code that you want to write. This is basically equivalent to a template declaration that requires sequence, yes?
And then when you say the type of S, is that this function, is the actual type of the sequence?
Yes. Writing, so the question is, writing decal type of S inside of this algorithm will give you the deduced type of whatever S was. So vector of int, but not, actually decal type would give you vector of int reference. Because that's declared as a reference, right? Yeah. Okay. Ah. All right. Actually, one of my last few slides. This is great. So one of the other features of concepts that I'm not going to talk a lot about that actually ends up being really cool and has some very interesting usage is that you can actually overload based on concepts. So here I have two versions of a find algorithm. The first one works for sequences, and I've gone ahead and added another requirement, which is the equality type has to be equality comparable, which means it has to have equals and not equals and do the right thing here, because find requires that. You can't actually use find without comparing these elements for equality, right? So I've added a constraint here to allow that, and then I've created a new version of find that takes a set. And here set is going to be unordered set, unordered multiset, unordered or standard set, standard multiset, one of those, basically, or any other kind of associative structure that we want, really anything with find. And so when we call find, if you call find with a sequence, we get the one with the sequence. If you call find for a set, these are non-overlapping concepts, by the way. We don't have both of them. If you call it for set, you get that overload. And the way that works is that a sequence would satisfy these concepts, or these constraints, but not those. So this gets dropped from your overload set. A set would not satisfy these constraints, because a set is not a sequence, doesn't have pushback, for example. And this would get dropped from your overload set. This would not. So constraints in overload resolution actually act as kind of a tiebreaker. So they act as two things. They act as a filter, which we use enable if and sfina for all day long these days. So they act as a filter on your overload set. But in case of multiple declarations, they also act as a tiebreaker. So if you have two declarations that happen to have the same type, you compare the constraints. And the canonical example of that is actually advance. So here's the advance algorithm with all three versions declared in the same scope. There's one for input iterators, there's one for bidirectional iterators, there's one for I almost said output iterators, that would have been fun. Random access iterators. And so now if I call advance with a pointer, all of these are going to be valid. They're all valid. They're all viable overloads, right? Because a pointer is also an input iterator. A pointer is also bidirectional. Pointer is also random access. So what we actually have to do is compare the constraints of each of these algorithms and actually order them by the sets of requirements that they have. Bidirectional has more requirements than input iterator. Technically, the way that we say this is that the bidirectional iterator constraints subsume those of input iterator. Random access iterator constraints subsume those of bidirectional iterator. And so when we order these things, we end up picking the one that's the most constrained. And so calling advance on a pointer will give us the overload that best satisfies the requirements of that algorithm. Yes? Can you repeat that again?
Can you write constraints in terms of other constraints?
Can you build one concept on another? I think
he's asking. Oh, can you build one concept on another? Yes. In fact, bidirectional iterator should require input iterator. Random access should require bidirectional. Yeah, absolutely. Composition of concepts leads very naturally to these kinds of things. Yeah.
What if you don't know the concept of what you're using? Say in the previous slide, could you say in the first one, I want the requirement of find?
So the question is, can we refer to other declarations and lift their constraints into our own declaration? I thought about it, and I didn't bring it up because I was focused on this other stuff. So if you really want that, you write a paper. I thought about it. I don't know. Like it seems like it's useful, but you know, find might be an overload set. Which constraints do you pick? Well, I mean, if technically it's fine as a template, it already is an overload set. But it could have multiple specializations, multiple overloads, right?
What if you have two concepts that maybe don't have any relationship to each other, like sequence and serializable, or something like that? Is there a way, do you have to combine them into a separate concept, or can you name them?
No, they're just separate concepts. They're like, we have an output streamable or something like that, which is just the cout streaming stuff that's totally separate from every other concept out there. There's no requirement that these are related in any way.
If I have an algorithm that uses something that's streamable and is a sequence.
So the question is, if I have two versions of an algorithm that require unrelated concepts that are both satisfied by their arguments, and neither is more specialized.
Right.
Ambiguous. The answer is that we can deduce them in every case because what you actually write in these concepts, so the question was, is it based on name, is subsumption based on name inclusion, or is there some other mechanism at work? And the answer is some other mechanism, because the things that you can write here, here and here, turn out to be transformed into a small predicate logic, so we're really just doing essentially theorem proving. Very, very small theorem proving on a very simple language, yeah. Yes. Which one was that?
In your list of three overlooks, the random access, you spelled access in random.
You know, that's funny because I actually had an assert with three S's in it earlier too, but I caught that this morning. Yeah. Well, a concept is the predicate that establishes what requirements need to be satisfied. A template introduction, where did my introductions go? There we go. These things just introduce declarations. So mergeable is a concept defined somewhere else. This is just saying, this thing is going to be a template with these parameters and that constraint, and then here's the rest of the declaration. So the concept is Well, I'll clarify after. Yes.
Is there a way if you have a concept that subsumes another concept, but the difference is only a semantic difference? Is there a way to say that a certain model corresponds to that other concept?
So the question is, how do you differentiate types or differentiate concepts that vary only by semantics, like input iterator and forward iterator?
For example, contiguous iteration, for example.
So the way that we would do that is by using a traits class or some kind of tag class to actually dispatch on those things. Because we can't capture semantics in Concepts Lite, you know, you still have to resort to some sort of pre-existing techniques to do that sort of stuff. But only when it comes down to semantics. For input iterator? For forward iterator, yeah, it works. We'd have another one for contiguous iterator.
Specialization. Explicit specialization with a concept name wouldn't work?
Specialization. So the question is, can you specialize a concept name? No, you cannot. You cannot specialize a concept. Yes?
So I'm just thinking about the error messages that you provided before. We have a highly complex concept based on all the other concepts, and the error message is just, if you don't fit this concept, wouldn't it be easier and better just to have that whole huge template error message so you can figure out what the real problem is and how to fix it?
So the question is, when diagnosing constraints failures in complex systems, should you dump everything or just give a simple answer? And the answer is, I don't know. Heuristics. So I have to go back and actually rework the diagnostic systems in GCC because I want more information. But you don't want everything. You really don't want everything. Because a lot of these concepts end up including themselves multiple times. Like you might have sort of branches in the logical systems. And as you walk back through these to try to diagnose the constraints, you're just going to end up dumping a bunch of, if you have a naive solution, you're just going to end up dumping a bunch of redundant diagnostics. So you got to be kind of careful how you actually want to diagnose these things. Yeah.
Presumably, you're going to be able to, you can control what the verbosity of the diagnostics that is going to give you, so that in that case, you can dump everything if you want.
So the observation is that you should be able to control the verbosity of the compiler output. Unfortunately, I haven't seen in GCC a dash f error level equals, and I haven't written it yet, so not yet, yeah.
Well, I mean, maybe you don't want everything all the time, but you have to be able to get it, no matter what.
Well, sure, we can spitball on these arguments, these design decisions all day. But until somebody contributes code to GCC, so I'm not the only implementer of the language, I'll accept a patch that does that. But it has to do it right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did you have a question? No? Okay.
Yeah. One thing about the template introduces what might be confusing about the size that there are no return types.
Oh, God damn it. Sure, there are. They're implicit. No, don't. They're not. They're not. See, we program by magic. All right, continuing. So what we can do for overloading, we can also do for class template partial specialization. And this is the example that I always give, mostly because I can't think of anything better that is not a type trait. So if we actually have complex numbers, we might have two specializations of those. One would be for floating point types, which is the usual complex number. And for integral algorithms, we actually get something called a Gaussian integer, which we might have slightly different operations or semantics or complexities. And so we might have a partial specialization of this. Now, the reason that I have an undefined primary template is that there's a rule that whatever partial specializations you have must be more specialized than the primary. And this actually brings up a good opportunity to talk about something. We order overloads and we order partial specializations by their constraints. Type name is, well, this, an unconstrained template, is always less specialized than a constrained template. It doesn't matter what your constraints actually are. For example, you can write requires true, and that's still more constrained than an unconstrained template, which is weird, but it leads to some interesting things that you can do. So both of these guys are more specialized. Neither floating point nor arithmetic is more specialized than the other, and there's no overlap in these types. So if you instantiate this, if you use this thing correctly, you will actually get an appropriate instantiation, either for complex numbers or Gaussian integers. All right, so summary. This has kind of been a roundabout way of talking about concepts, but I still like doing it. The reason that we actually allow things to have different, it's the same name but with different syntax, is that it supports generic programming, right? So concepts are predicates. They allow us to group or collect or define sets of types that correspond to the requirements of actual algorithms that we want to write. Things like append or find or count or sort. Right? Concepts enable generic programming. It's nothing else. Because there's no way that you can write a template or a macro or some fragment of code that you're going to weave into your system in some way that I haven't said. I don't know, maybe aspect-oriented programming will make a comeback. We can talk about concepts that way. There's no way that you can actually do that without having some preconceived notion of what that program actually does. You have to know what the types of your values are, the types of your identifiers are. You have to know what the semantics of those operations are. You can't do that without having some mechanism for reasoning about it. It doesn't necessarily have to be in the language, but it's always there. Templates do help too. I'm not going to lie, templates are nice. Concepts make them better. Concepts are used to constrain templates. That's the big feature that we have for concepts. We can also overload and partially specialize with concepts. It's cool. It's neat. It leads to a lot of interesting things that you can do. But realistically, I haven't actually used these features a whole lot, at least in terms of refinement and overloading. Like, there's a reason I keep giving advance as my canonical example for refinement, which is that it's the, sort of the poster child of what's supposed to happen there. Same with next, right? If you guys get into implementing type traits using concepts, you'll use this a lot, especially the partial specialization. Because I'm the guy maintaining the compiler that does this, and I have like 20 users, and they all send me their bug reports, I know pretty much what everybody's working on. And it's funny because almost everybody, when they start picking this up, turns around and starts writing type traits libraries, which is a really good source of bugs. But, What? Did I hear something? It's a really good source of bugs, but it's not really what we were designed for. And they end up doing a lot of the partial specialization stuff. So that's actually gotten a lot of exercise. All right, so obviously this talk is not everything about concepts. I missed a lot of stuff. I'm not talking about designing concepts. Like, how do you know when you've designed a good concept? What makes a good concept? What operations should you require? What should you leave out? There are lots of questions that we can talk about here. I'm not talking about those, unfortunately. How do you effectively use concepts to define a generic library? That's a big question. We're still learning that. Now, I know that we typically think of ourselves as generic programming experts, but this is a brand new feature, and you will rethink how you actually write generic libraries. I do. So have some of the users that I've been working with. Things change. The rules that we have today will not be the rules that you have when you're using concepts. Right? I didn't really talk about the language specification. I could. but nobody really wants to hear it because it's pretty verbose. There's a lot of interesting things that happen here. And if you know what happens here, then a lot of your questions are answered pretty, it depends how much you like reading standardies. If you know how the language works, then a lot of your questions get answered pretty easily. There's a whole bunch of things that concepts give us also. This is a good jumping off point for a lot of interesting new features or new ideas. In particular, one of the things that we find from using concepts is that there's a lot of interaction with things like proxy iterators that don't really work out the way we want them to. So we're actually helping to exercise the points of the language that we might not have done the best job providing providing the same level of support for user-defined abstractions that we do for built-in abstractions. Proxy iterators, I think, like the poster child of that problem. I'm not talking about how this goes into C++ yet. It should happen. Not sure when. I don't know what the timeline is. I don't know what changes will happen to Concepts Lite as it goes forward, only that there will be some. So there's lots of stuff left over that we could talk about, but I think I'm down to like 5 minutes, maybe 10 minutes. Wow. So if you guys want to ask questions about those, I'll do my best to answer or show you more slides with bugs on them.
We have a microphone that we use for questions.
OK, yeah, look, questions. Yes?
Why is it called Concepts Lite? So
wait a second.
Run. Yes.
So yeah. Why is it called Concepts Lite, supposed to just concepts? Is real concept coming?
So the light part of it was to emphasize the fact that we were striving for the minimum set of language changes needed to define concepts, constrain templates, provide overloading. We didn't want to grab new declarations, we didn't want to grab syntax, we didn't want to fundamentally change the way certain things work in C++, we don't want to redefine what it means to look up names inside of templates, because that's hard. It's light because it was initially conceived as a small change to C++. It did get a little bit bigger over time, but you know, that happens. Yeah.
Going back to the template introduction syntax, wouldn't it be more natural to use angle brackets instead of curly?
Oh, no, that's actually ambiguous. You don't want to do that. Because what happens if you try to use angle brackets after a concept name is that the compiler starts to think that you're trying to satisfy the concept or actually check it.
But don't you need requires before you do that?
No. No. It just ends up becoming something interesting. So we use braces because they weren't used in that space. Beeman.
A comment on the first question. It's very important to understand that for C++ 11, the committee, standards committee, tried to do concepts heavyweight.
Yeah.
And it became so complex, and many aspects of it were very contentious because we had no experience. What Concepts Lite gives us, among other things, is a mechanism to develop that experience. And so when we try to answer a lot of the questions that aren't yet answered, we have some experience to base that on.
Right, and I'll actually add to that. Like, one of the things that I'm benefiting with Concepts Lite is the fact that we have a new vehicle in the ISO to deliver experimental features. This is not something that we had in pre-C++ 11. Like, everything that was proposed had to go into the core language. And so there was a huge risk with concepts, C++ OS concepts going in, because they were so new and they were so large. And this, the TS vehicle for the ISO actually lets us push off something experimental and we'll play with it before we decide whether or not or what parts of it actually go back into the language. So it gives us an opportunity to experiment and play and learn.
There have been some extensions to Concepts Lite recently by the committee, and I was wondering, could you quickly summarize what those extensions are and their rationale?
There have not yet been, I wasn't at the C++ meeting last week, which is unfortunate, because there was some discussion about changes to Concepts Lite that could be characterized as extensions. One of them was to replace, I will sort of summarize a bunch of national body comments in one statement. One of them was to replace that notion of concept bool with a legitimate concept declaration. That should happen. Like, I think that should happen in the long term. but we still need a paper for it to explore design issues and other stuff, right? There was a paper a couple of years ago by Botan Balo, and I actually helped write that, that was related to the introduction syntax. We kind of put that on the back burner for a while. Basically allowed you to specify a name for any deduced type using the same introduction syntax. You could write like auto, braces, T, and you just get the name of the deduced type as T. That might come back. I think somebody just has to revive the paper and rerun it through core or evolution. So those are the main ones that I know about. I'm sure that people are providing or designing others. I know that I've been talking to Zach Lane over here about a fairly ambitious one that we've made no progress on because people get busy and you drop the ball sometimes, right? But that one was actually related to type erasure. It was actually a very, very interesting project. So, yes.
When we implement algorithms using concepts, how to make sure the only permitted functions are used in the algorithm? Is there any good way to check it, that?
So the existing best practice for checking the use of names within template definitions is to go back through a system called archetypes. If you look through the Boost concept library, there's this whole library of archetype classes set up that you can use to instantiate templates and determine if you have errors in there. That still seems to be the state of the art as far as I know. I haven't really kept up to date on that development so much because I've been doing other stuff, but that's tends to be what can be done. I don't think most people do that though, at least not from my experience. They're just sort of based on code review and testing.
Thank you.
Actually, I had a question over here from earlier. What was I asked you to ask me after? So the question was, can you use requires outside of a concept? And the answer is no. And the reason for that is because whenever you try to ask if you can require something outside of a Sphene context, your compiler really wants to type check those expressions. And so you get into something like, check to see if bool has minus minus. And of course it doesn't. And so instead of returning something like false, which would be in a requires expression, your compiler will go, ill-formed. So in order to actually support that, compilers actually have to take something starting in the requires expression and ending the requires expression saying, look, this is really a Sphene context. I know we're not inside of a template. I know we're not in any kind of overload resolution state, but pretend like you are and don't type check, or don't type check so aggressively. And by extension, and this is kind of an odd thing that we sort of missed in the TS, but there's a reason for it. By extension, you also you're not allowed to use a concept outside of one of those contexts either. So statically asserting something like sequence is not guaranteed to work because that's not in a context where you can trap all type errors. GCC work has actually allowed this through various pains, but it wasn't easy. Like there are a lot of places where things look like template specialization that need to not be type checked in the usual way in order for that to work. So one of the reasons we didn't necessarily go for that or include that capability in the TS was because we weren't sure how hard it would be for every other compiler to actually implement that. And it hasn't exactly been straightforward in GCC either. Okay.
So you'd mentioned that you guys don't do use checking now.
Right.
Can you actually even add it later after you have a body of code that doesn't use it? Because wouldn't you break programs that depend on things that are not in the concept, and now those programs are broken? Well, can you actually add it later?
I mean, we're kind of doing that now, right? Like, we don't do any use checking, we don't do any interface checking in C++. So what we've always relied on is testing and review, and that's going to be the status quo until somebody decides to flip that switch. Now, there's an interesting question is whether or not we should always reject a template that does use dependent names. And I don't know if that's necessarily an obvious yes.
My question is on top of the last question, and has been considered to have using names that don't exist in the concept that was specified on the algorithm to be an error that doesn't have to be diagnosed by the compiler, so that it doesn't have a real breakage for when compiler-generated archetypes are used for checking algorithms.
Can you re-ask that? I think I got lost a little somewhere.
Right now, it doesn't check the algorithms for if you use functions that doesn't have been specified on that concept, right?
Right.
So has it been considered to have that being not well-formed program, but doesn't have that as a diagnostic requirement for the compiler? So that when it's introduced archetype, compiler-generated archetype for testing algorithms, then the correct programs, well-formed programs, will all pass.
So my student Braden and I started doing a little bit of work on that early last summer. And the intent was to actually do something fairly close to what you suggest, which was that when compiling under a certain mode, if you had these use errors in your templates, you'd get like a warning instead of an error. So you could actually turn on a flag that would sort of check, like strictly check that template definition. Unfortunately, we didn't make a lot of progress on it because we got overwhelmed by writing the spec and the compiler and maintaining bugs and fixing bugs, stuff like that. So we haven't made a lot of progress on it.
Okay, a few more questions. I think we have a little more time, yeah?
It depends what's next.
Okay.
I can stand up here.
Will there be standard library concepts?
Yes, there will be standard library concepts. Ask Eric Niebler. Eric is working on what will become the next TS related to concepts, which is actually the ranges TS, and that includes the first library support for using concepts throughout the entirety of the STL, but not the entirety of the standard language.
I don't know enough about it to actually ask the question other than to drop a name. I know Matt Calabrese, for example, is against your idea of concepts. I don't know exactly the reasons why, but I'm wondering, is there a vocal camp in opposition, and what are the reasons for the problem?
I think the most vocal opposition that I've heard is that there are people that really want this sort of concept map-like behavior. If you think about C++ OX, we had this feature called concept maps that would give you a way of sort of explicitly saying whether you satisfied a concept or not. And so most of the people that I hear talking about why this is not good will generally reference, you know, this sort of concept map-like feature for satisfying concepts. It wasn't really in our set of use cases when we did the work for N3351. We didn't need it. So we didn't pursue developing it.
Concept maps are more attached, right? If I write, if you have a group concept that needs a star operator multiply, and I write a Abelian group that has a plus, well, the Abelian group is a group, except that I call it a plus, we call it a star. You figure I have to write some kind of proxy class, right, to get that behavior, which is kind of annoying.
Well, I mean, the alternative is that you redefine name lookup, right?
So, is it possible to have a concept that takes a template parameter, something like higher order concepts?
Ask that one more time.
Is it possible to define a concept that takes a template parameter instead of type name, you know?
It is possible to define a concept that takes a template parameter, yes. You can define a concept that constrains integers, actually any non-type parameter, type parameter, template parameter. You can do all of that stuff. No reason why you couldn't. Why not be general?
But it's because I tried it with GCC CLI and didn't work, I think. But I was just trying to probably messed up.
Okay.
Is it possible to static assert, like if I implement my vector and I want to static assert the sequence of my vector?
It is not permitted by the TS in the current wording. There's a national body comment that basically asks to support that. We're going to get papers on it, so it'll probably happen. GCC will support it. Modulo bugs and weird template instantiation stuff. It'll definitely do it. There, by the way, there's a little idiom that you can use to work around that. Like, what you end up doing is defining two functions. One is unconstrained. The other is constrained by the concept that you want to check. And they both return true and false. Or one returns false, the other returns true. So there's a small idiom that you can use to actually generate and guarantee that check will work because it pushes the constraint check into the declaration. But it's not ideal. I understand that.
How does concept checking work when using it against hard errors? Or does it work essentially like how substitution failure works? Or
it does. It's exactly substitution failure. Actually, this is easy to tell you how it works. Here. That'll be here. Right. So basically what we do whenever we go to check this concept, actually after we finish declaring the template, what you do is you take all the constraints. So you see the sequence up there, you transform that into a constraint, you take this requires clause, transform that into a constraint, and then what you do is you inline all the concept checks. So you take all the definitions of all those concepts and you lift them into one single expression that you then check exactly in that context, which is a Sphene context. So concepts are by nature designed to be Sphene friendly, so we don't run into these hard errors. Like we automatically inline all of our concept definitions specifically to avoid that weird non-immediate context stuff.
So it basically converts like the hard errors into substitution failures then?
When
possible.
I mean, you are still going to write programs that will give you hard errors while you are concept checking. And I guarantee that at least a dozen of you guys will make this mistake in the next year and a half. You will define a function with an auto-deduce return type, because everybody loves the new auto-deduce return type. You will run it through a concept check and you're gonna get a hard error. Because the requirements for generating the type of that function are that you have to go instantiate the definition. And if that auto-deduce return type is not constrained properly, you're gonna get a substitution failure in a non-immediate context and you get right back to hard errors. So, as a corollary, don't use auto-deduce return types with concepts. That's just how the language works. Maybe somebody can fix it, but it's not concept's fault. I know you've had your hand up for a while.
There's a circular buffer class in Boost. It has a pushback.
Uh-oh.
I take it you wouldn't recommend that.
I don't think so. I think I would not recommend that, no. It's
not strictly a fact assertion.
Yeah. I'm not sure if circular buffer satisfies the linear arrangement. Maybe it does, I don't know. It's worth talking about. But yeah, it's a good question.
Well, it does destroy an element.
Oh yeah, that's right, it does destroy. You ruin that property, right? Don't preserve original elements.
Of course, then there's everybody's poster child for a bad sequence container, std array.
I love arrays. Well, that's not a sequence, it's not dynamically extendable.
Right.
It's a range. We're still calling them ranges, right, Eric? There have been some name changes. All right.
So my name was invoked. I'm the one who's really against these concepts. But so I figured I'd just lay out my views. I guess, first of all, it's not so much concept maps that I'm worried about. It's actually the archetype problem, which is currently there's no checking of constrained template bodies. And there's been this sort of statement that it may come in the future, but it hasn't really been proven yet that the specification via usage patterns actually has a way to create some kind of an archetype that makes sense.
Well,
in the general case.
So use checking based on this technique would not be based on creating an archetype. Right?
But
under the hood, this is just a constraint system.
Right.
So what we really end up doing if we want to provide separate checking or use checking is that you end up having a constraint solver that actually takes all the constraints that you've required, all the expressions and types and values in your algorithm, and checking to see if the constraints that you've written actually solve the names that you need in your algorithm. So we don't actually create archetypes. There's a completely different logical system.
Right, but in order to actually get checking of bodies, like do this multi-phase checking, I know of no other way other than to generate archetypes that
I just told you the different way.
Implement it. Implement it with usage patterns, I guess, and then I will believe it. But other than that, there are other issues. For one, the original concepts proposal had explicit concept satisfaction, which is something that was also brought up today, which was how do you differentiate between forward iterator and input iterator if they have exactly the same requirements? And the current answer is to use type traits. The old proposal, the C++11 proposal, had just a way of stating that a particular concept was explicit, and you could, if it was labeled explicit, you had to state that you were satisfying it.
Right.
And so one of the reasons why C++ 11 concepts was deemed too complicated was because certain people thought that that would be too verbose for users. But if the answer to that is to use type traits, I don't see how that has solved the problem. So I feel like
how often do you think you actually need that feature?
If you want to be pedantic, a lot. But
really?
I think the very fact that it's in the standard library with input iterator and forward iterator is already enough of a reason to say, hey, this is somewhat important. But that's beside that. What we had in C++ 11 was something that did constraint checking. It had explicit concept maps, and it had things like automatic deduction of associated types, which cannot be done here. And if the reason why it was cut was because it was too complicated, we could have just scaled it back. And Doug Greger wrote a paper regarding exactly this fact. He even proposed removing explicit concepts and things like that. And the benefit I see of this is there was a very clear route forward towards getting all these features back if and when they were actually shown to be necessary, which in my personal opinion, they already are necessary. But right now, because we don't have any proven way of doing things like checking of constrained template bodies, it's not clear that we're not kind of painting ourselves into a corner. And that is my biggest worry. So those are my thoughts on Concepts Lite. So.
Well, I mean, you are free not to use it. And if you really want to pursue a different way of doing this, you are free to propose that, write the spec, implement it. I mean, there is a path towards getting that view into the C++, right?
Right. I guess my main question is why didn't we just scale back the original proposal? Is it just that nobody wrote a paper to scale it back, or
the guy sitting behind you can probably answer that question very well.
Gabby.
Sorry, we need to.
The previous concept specification was fundamentally flawed. It couldn't be rescued by just scaling back to what we didn't know. So we needed to start from a clean slate, from the basics, try to get the basics right, and that's what we did.
I guess.
Well, I think that discussion can be had off time. We're late here.